it doesn't have to do anything with the question asked. So if you have a really specific task, it's far easier to create clean code. And what is really important is stay out of chaos. And this means actually use some kind of management system which works for you, or a process like Scrum or Kanban. If you're interested in Kanban, by the way, I think tomorrow there's also a talk on the conference about Kanban. Makes really sense to use stuff like that, and be sure that your developer actually feels comfortable in this process. Okay, the next step, the unit testing. In Flow and Niels, I don't know who of you already made some tests with Flow and Niels, but we have a little bit more than just unit testing. We also have functional testing, where you can actually test the code in your application and how it would work in an application context. And we also have behavior-driven development. We have some behavior-driven testing using BHAT, where really functional features can be described in a feature definition. So we have some more tests, and but still I think it's really important that you do your tests as a developer and run them enough. The next step is one which is really interesting, because I think this is what developers do the best. They break stuff all day. And that's a good thing. But on the other hand, if you have a lot of unit tests and they are green all day, you can be pretty proud. You can say, like, all my tests were all green. On the other hand, you could also say, maybe my tests are not specific enough, because if they never break, then you are missing something in your tests, because you constantly develop on your application, so it should break from time to time. And then we have the staging stage. And here I actually took the staging and testing together, because that's how it normally would work in Flow. This guy in this blog post said, like, okay, when a feature is done, the feature should be tested as is, just only the feature. That would be basically the unit testing. And you should test from various angles. So it could be that your feature is used in different contexts, for example, and you should not test just one. And he said the testing stage is a full system test over all features, and he prefers to test on cloned live data. I think this is what we mostly do with Flow, except for the cloned live data. If we send in a change in a Flow project, you would normally run all the tests over your full project, so everything is tested constantly. Okay, and then we have the emulating phase. And he says, test your software on production hardware. I've had quite some discussions with people about doing this, because this has some implications. I've heard system administrators say, like, okay, your test environment has to be on the same server as your production server. Would be useful, but it's the question if it really should work. I think there are multiple ways to actually have a solution for this emulating. And I will try to explain a possible concept in Surf. I didn't try it out yet, but we come back to this later. And of course, you have the production server. And on your production server, you don't forget to do your monitoring, and you don't forget to do your logging. Because if something goes wrong, you have to go back in your process, change stuff, deploy again. And I think this is all part of the deployment. Like, you go from the start of the development to getting something live. Who has ever had something going wrong with a deployment? I see some hands. I want to see more, actually. We read the story about a company in the United States that made a nice record with losing about 170,000 euros a second. Nobody? Ah, cool. Okay. There's actually a story which was posted on the internet a while ago of a company in the United States, and they had to a software application, and in this application they created a feature which never really worked. It was there, but it was never really put in production. They knew it was broken. It did something, but it wasn't good enough. And they had a nice feature flag to disable this feature, which is useful, because It didn't do anything. And then they created a new feature which has to be released. And they were thinking like, okay, if you now create a new feature, we can maybe remove the old code of the broken feature. And if we remove this code of the broken feature, we can reuse the feature flag. That's pretty smart, actually. And they deployed this program to the production server. I think, actually, I imagine that those guys were just like, okay, guys, we did it. It's live. It's on production server. Victory, beer. But something went wrong in the deployment. They had 8 production servers. And one server didn't get the new software, but the feature flag was enabled. That's painful, actually. So the system sent some emails, some warning emails, and the employees were thinking like, okay, nice emails, we get them all day. And they probably had some filters on the mailbox, so they were all redirected or into the trash. So nobody really responded to the error. And this ended up in this part of software, which was actually sending new orders to the stock exchange. So that was quite some money which they lost. And in the end, the total damage was $460 million, including the fine which they got because they didn't have any process in place for actually managing this. What I want to point out here is that it's really important as a company to keep these processes running and monitor them, because it can go wrong. And I think in this case, it was even a bankruptcy. So the company was gone. And that's, I would say, a pretty bad situation. You don't want to run into that. And this could, of course, all go wrong because of human error, stuff you really cannot predict. There are just unexpected things happening. But also a lack of validation. If you don't check what you put live, then how can you ever be sure that it's actually, yeah, live like you expected it to be live? And then we have the next one. It won't happen to me. Of course it will happen to you. It happens to everybody at some point. Also this, just from a practical example, for example, I've seen companies saying like, we deploy using Git. We put a Git checkout on the live server, and the only thing we do is checking out a new tag, or we just pull in the master. That is a way of deploying, and if you have this in your processes and it's all defined, and that's all fine to me. But if some manager says, like, we now have this quick bug fix which has to be done, and we don't have any money, so this intern is going to fix it. What are you going to do as a developer if you need to do your next deployment and you do Git status on the live server and you think, like, ha, seems to be a completely different website? Or that's just not gonna work, and that's quite dangerous. So I would say deployment is a mindset, and I really hope that people will see it like this, because you have to be working on your deployment process from the beginning on, because it's just the way you get your money and the way you can lose money if you don't, by the way. Now I would like to go into what you could have as a common setup for your development and your deployment. Of course, you have your development environment where developers work. They work together. They work on their own machine. They work somewhere you don't even know. Maybe they even work on paper, and they somehow send in the changes into your versioning system. And of course, you do some kind of reviewing. If it's a pre-commit, if it's post-commit, if it's using pull requests, doesn't really matter. But please review your code and be sure about the actual quality. I've heard people say, like, okay, you introduce Garrett, then who do you think you are to watch my code and have an opinion about my code? If that would have been my employee, he would have been fired instantly. Because if you have a bookkeeper who says, like, you are not going to look in my bookkeeping, that's stupid. You fire this guy, and for developers, I would say the same. You have some kind of build server, I imagine. This build server using Surf could be your local machine if it works. It could be a Jenkins server. It could be whatever. It could be just a bash script if it's up to me. But please try at least to have one single point actually deploying your stuff. and you have your production server. Otherwise, deploying doesn't make sense. Well, what I said, you could have your development environment. It could be local, it could be shared. You could use Vagrant, maybe, which is something I'm pretty happy about. But don't kill the freedom of the developer. I've seen companies where the developer was pretty limited in the software he was allowed to install or doing the changes to configuration in applications. And they were just limited in the way they could actually develop. And if you limit the developer, you can do less innovative stuff. So try to keep that in mind. And keep your changes small, because small changes are easy to review, they're easy to merge, and big changes are, well, harder to merge. This is, by the way, something we notice a lot also in Flow, where it's so easy to wait a long time to merge something because we have this high quality standard. The longer you wait, the more work you actually have to do. Okay? For the version system, of course you use one. Who is not using a version system here, by the way, for developing? No hands at all. Cool. Most of the people probably using Subversion or Git. Really stick to that and use your branching and have your review process in place, but also start nitpicking. And we nitpick a lot in our team, and we all like being nitpicked because you learn a lot from the minor little things sometimes said in a review. And this could be just like, okay, you have some error in your white space or whatever, and that could be a little bit too much. So, but also I learned that some PHP functions are just faster than the other one, just by the comments and reviews. But try to keep it motivational. So if you review something, don't say like you did a bad job, but say like, okay, guy, you have done pretty good effort in trying to get this done. Thank you for what you've done, but maybe you could optimize this part. And if you have the feeling that this guy doesn't know how to do that, just say like, okay, I will push a follow-up and we'll go through the code together and learn something. Well, the Jenkins server could be something with, could be something Jenkins, webhooks, or whatever. I personally use Jenkins, which is pretty easy to set up and works pretty cool. And then one little note about your production server. Keep it production only. I will say some stuff later on which conflicts with this one. But I have learned since I started to deploy using, for example, Composer, that Composer is actually a development tool. And if something on your production server breaks because Composer doesn't really do what you expected, then you don't have a good day. Actually, at some point, my production server broke 11 o'clock in the evening. And I couldn't pull in new changes from GitHub because a disk was broken. You say 10? Okay. And it actually took me the full night, which was pretty much not what I planned to have. I will quickly skip over this because for deployment, you could deploy manually automated bash, and we have this lot of solutions. But we came up with Type-Free-Serve. I think it was started about 3 years ago. And it was because there was a need for a simple deployment tool. And not everything you're going to see now will be called simple, I think. But at least it's easy if your development team knows the language in which you write your scripts for deployment. Well, I have some quick misunderstandings. Just don't think it's for enterprise only. Deployment is not expensive, and Serve is just easy to set up, so there's no limit for you to say, okay, we are not going to work with it. The same is that it's not just type of free. If you would like to deploy anything else, just do it. I've heard situations of people actually packaging stuff in zip and send it to another server or whatever. And of course, it's based on Flow. Okay, Surf works using deployment descriptions, which is basically a build script. You can use a set of predefined tasks, so you can create your own one. Every task can have options applied, so it's pretty flexible. And one description describes the flow in which you are going to do your deployment, and you can simulate them to be sure you actually have the right scripts. By default, Surf comes with a simple workflow. And if you would like, you can create your own custom workflow. But I'm not so sure how simple the simple workflow actually is, because it has a few stages. And these are actually three more stages than you would have seen, or maybe two more stages than in all the other Surf talks till now. Because in the beginning, we only had initialize, update, migrate, finalize, test, switch, and cleanup, I think. Is that correct? Yeah. But we introduced package and transfer. What it actually means, the initialize stage is the stage where Surf sets up the environment. Like on the production server, they take care of all the folders being there, which you'll need later on. The package state is locally, so you can package your application. I use this in my setup for running Composer locally, and I'm running, pulling all the dependencies, and I remove the stuff I don't like. Then we have the transfer method stage, which is actually sending the data to the server. Then we have the update, which should take care of updating code on the live server. This could be used if you use a Composer install in your production server. And we have the migrate, which calls database migrations to be sure that your database's structure is in sync. And then we have finalize, which I wouldn't have really a description for currently. It could be the cache warm-up, I think, pre-building your caches. Then we have a testing phase where you can just say, like, OK, we now have it's all transferred. Does it all work? And if it all works, we have the switch, which basically is switching a symlink. So if you prepare everything and everything is working in your test, then we come to the word zero downtime deployment, because switching a symlink can almost be ignored in the time it takes. So it's about milliseconds. Of course, there could be a web server configuration or one visitor having a hit which doesn't work, but I heard that Apache actually now also has modules to keep track of changing symlinks. So you can really make it a zero downtime deployment. And then we have the cleanup, which we always need. What we now have as supported transfer methods is Git and rsync. If you think Git is not really a transfer method, well, it is somehow, because we can do a remote checkout on the production server. So if you have Git on your production server, which I don't have, but if you have it, you can pull in the code, and that's a way of transferring. By default, Surf comes with four types of applications you can deploy. The application types are basically some kind of predefined steps you have to do for deployment. Like, we have the base application, which could be every PHP application you would like. We have Type3 CMS, we have Flow, we have Neos. And we have the possibility to create your own applications. That's what we do in our company. But I won't explain this now because of the time. But if you would like to know how we handle this, then come to me. I will quickly show you how an rsync deployment could work. And I will also quickly say why I use rsync. I think having Git on your server is not really a cool idea. I already said the same about Composer. And rsync just has a pretty quick way of transferring the stuff, because only the changed files are actually transferred. A deployment of my website currently takes about 20 seconds, and I think that's pretty acceptable. Well, how does it work with a deployment? We have the initialization stage. And in the initialization stage, Surf will make sure that on the production server, actually the following directories exist: cache, releases, and shared. The cache folder is used to keep track of the code, your normal code base. It could be a Git clone checkout, for example. Shared is the folder where all your shared data is stored. It could be your Type3 temp folder or your uploads. And the releases is the interesting one where we actually send the code to. Then we go to the package state, and in the package state I actually make a local clone of my project on my local disk, and I run Composer install on my, in this case on the build server, and all the code is really prepared to be ready to go to the server, and it's rsynced to the cache folder in the first step. Now we go into the update state, and there's a new release folder created in my releases path. You see it's marked with the date, and on this point, a symlink occurs which would point to the next release to be deployed. Then I run a database migration, and after the database migration, I have a separate vhost, which is next.example.com, pointing to my next symlink. I can do a get just a curl request to the server. If I get a status code 200, then it's all live. It should be OK. And then I say, like, OK, guys, switch the symlink. And from now on, server will say your new website is live. If you think about a database migration just happening before switching the symlink, it could, of course, happen that in your migration scripts, you remove a database field. Try to do this in multiple steps. Like if you have to remove something, first remove the functionality in one change, do a deployment, and in the next change, remove the database fields. In this case, it will not break. Okay, a quick example, what could happen on a multi-node deployment. If you have three servers to deploy, it will first run the initialized state on all servers, then the package state, and then it continues like this. So you can actually use serve for deploying multiple nodes at the same time. Okay, just quickly about deploying NEOS. In NEOS, it's possible to have full content staging using a structure which we have put in an XML file, so you can actually deploy a new structure of your website. And of course, we have all kinds of migrations in NEOS available to actually update the content. So it's possible to have this fully implemented, and it's pretty fast, as I said already. For CMS, we have an extension called Extcore API. And Extcore API enables you to clear the cache from the command line, do a database compare, introduce new scheduler tasks, or create a nice news message for the next administrator to log in, which said the new version of your website is live. And it turns out that with content staging, it's possible with Type3 CMS. And Jonas is giving a talk just following on this one in another room about full content staging and CMS. And what I already said, like, you can deploy anything. I failed deploying one application, but that application couldn't manage to work with symlinks. I don't know why. But everything which could be in a symlink path will just work. So basically, it should all be fine. And you don't have Font Awesome on your MacBook. So this icon is for private use only, but it was actually a question mark. So are there any questions about the presentation? I think we have a few minutes left, or?
There's a break now, so you
okay. Yeah. Okay. Then I will at least not talk anymore, but are there questions about Surf or how we do stuff? Or everybody wants to have a break. Okay.
How long does it take to set up everything for project, medium project?
For medium project, if you...
Not a big one.
Yeah, for a small one, I would say, if you are a little bit familiar with Surf already, then for me it's minutes. It's just copying a task. And if you have to go into Surf, there are a lot of people also willing to give examples. And just join in Type3 Flow on IRC and you will get some scripts, yeah.
So what is the status of the documentation of Type3?
Yeah, next one. Thank you, good bridge. No, we still need support because Surf has to get this official Type3 product status somehow, and we are still working on getting the 1.0 out. And we said the same last year, which I realize, but we really need people to help building Surf and finalizing the documentation also. I think we are pretty close to a 1.0 release, but it has to be tuned and everybody has to be happy. And unfortunately, we don't really have the time to do so. So we could need some fresh blood. Yeah.
Maybe one additional sentence about this. I'm from the AI tutorial team of Chapter 3 in the world.
Mm-hmm.
And we plan to release soon the new product structure. And therefore, we also need some
some documentation. That's fine. You can. Christopher is probably a better one to go. And otherwise, if you can't find him, search for the tall guy.
Yeah.
Okay. Any more questions or? Yeah.
How do you handle database?
The database structure or the content?
Yeah.
Yeah. I think.
If you switch your test on the next preview.
Yeah.
.com and then you make changes.
Yeah, that's actually the emulation part, which I skipped now in the hurry to actually get it done. So feel free to leave, by the way, if you don't want to hear the answer. But I was currently thinking about if you deploy everything and just before the testing stage, you would create a clone of your live database. You can run the migrations on this clone and run all the tests. And if the tests pass, you are pretty sure that your production server will work if you run the migrations again on the production database. So the production, the running of the migrations is just, yeah, you can almost ignore the time which it takes. It's just a few queries which are executed. So my current bet would be on a structure like that, just create a clone during the deployment, run all the migrations, and just before the actual switch, run the migrations again on your production database. Okay, I would suggest if you have questions to go to me or Christopher Lübeck, indeed, and have a break now then. Thank you for listening. So.